It is very obvious to everybody who lives and works in the urban areas that an urban crisis infulging most part of the civilized world exists. The feeling of frustration is so strong that there are some willing to abandon the city altogether.
ਸਾਡਾ ਸਾਰੀ ਦੁਨੀਆ ਨੇ ਕੀ ਬਹਿਣਾ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਇੱਕ ਵਾਰ ਆ ਲੈ ਕੇ ਚਲਾ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਉਹਨੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਕੀ ਪੁੱਛਣਾ
The common bond of having to eke out a living plus desire to interact socially makes these people stay together. But the relentless quest for the greener pastures causes them to sever their roots and leave their homes. The basic perception of progress being synonymous with the city causes people to migrate to metropolis. Pursue the analogy, hopeful immigrants might often find their wings clipped by being caught in a vicious trap of inadequate shelter, encroachments, prohibitive land prices, and inflation. To curb man's innate desire for self-improvement in economic terms or otherwise is to stifle the human spirit which is constantly searching for fulfillment. Look at the condition of these people. Isn't there a need to revamp, to change the basic fabric of day-to-day living to suit the needs and condition of the people and the times? It is time that all antiquated and inapplicable planning strategies be re-evaluated. With the population increasing drastically, we tend more and more to concentrate on the already heavily populated areas. But unless we learn the true meaning of planning, which is injection of diversity and the variety into meaningful pattern, we will succeed in making our cities unlivable. Unworkable places of infernal streams, plagued by the discomforts arising from the shocking lack of the basic necessities of life. A fate within fantasy is better known as hell. The major protagonists of this unlivable hell are shelterless. Their needs, the future, the financing often becoming mere items at the boardroom discussions or seminars. In most developing nations, this problem of shelterless is more acutely felt in metropolitan areas. Planners, administrators, sociologists and architects have attempted to grapple with the situation intermittently. But like a launchless monster, the problem has eluded them. Not only because of this gargantuan size, but because of the consequential complications. The problem is man-made, thus apparent. The only way to tackle it is to understand it completely and above all, to have a holistic approach. Most of all, one has much to learn from the past, and the rationale of living with nature as propagated in our ancient text, known as Vastuvidya. This text needs to be demystified, and reasoning of linking human settlements to religion needs to be understood. These forms of guidelines for sustainable development, though mystified, exist in most developing countries. Perhaps one of the most dramatic symbols of development process in the country is environmental degradation. Droughts, famines, floods, soil erosion are the regular features of wanton deforestation. Industrial effluents contaminate natural water reservoirs. Pollutants poison in the air, leading to the numerous diseases and slow deaths. Grim statistics confirm deforestation links to global warming. These are all symptoms of environmental crisis, which is already upon us. It is not something to be vaguely concerned about, as some distant future possibility, but a contemporary reality. It is not the lament over a disappearing idyllic or pristine beauty, but a direct cry for survival. An inadequate comprehension of housing problem has resulted in large unauthorized colonies on flying lands in the city.
পাগল করে ধরছে বেড়া রাখছে তো পাগল করে ধরছে
এ যে বেড়া নেরে এ কে সে রাখছে.
In addition to this are the unemployed, educated, the destitute, senior citizens and working women, which when combined comprise almost 1/3 of Delhi's urban population. The same may be true in metros of other developing nations. Such disorientation puts severe environmental constraints upon both the city and the city dwellers. And the basic constitutional right of living with dignity is fast becoming a distant dream. In Delhi alone, the population of around 3 million inhabit such shanties on the prime public land, amounting to about 4,000 hectares. To use an analogy, this problem with no apparent feasible solution in sight seems to roll along like a veritable snowball, ever increasing in size.
चलन है. दिल्ली सरकार ने यह तय किया है कि जितने भी स्लम डवेलर्स हैं, झुग्गी झोपड़ी हैं, उनको उठा करके हम नए फ्लैट बना करके उनको देंगे और दिल्ली को स्लम फ्री करेंगे. ये इस समय शुरू हो गया है.
The failure of municipal bodies and government housing agencies is leading to public resentment and consequently to the breaking down of law and order. Although there is no threat of various planning strategies, technological efforts, slum clearance and rehabilitation schemes, government is constantly ready with new solutions, but the problems keep outpacing any solution. Surely it is time for the government to admit its limitations and face up to the reality of the situation. Evolving appropriate sustainable city strategies for developing as well as developed countries requires a re-examination of the modern day frameworks of the city as well as its components. The modern day framework has for over a century ensured that cities have developed in tandem with the political and economic resources. Sustainability can only be achieved as long as some very basic issues are examined, developed and implemented. Prior to the modernist movement, the majority of town planners, architects, engineers, artisans, etc. had natural understanding of the relationship between built form and the natural environment. In order to achieve sustainability, smooth amalgamations of traditional building practices and modern technologies can be developed and implemented. Amongst other things, we could do well to deal with the issues related to land, roads, water supply, water disposal, and appropriate building materials. Technologies that are appropriate at the national level must be segregated from those that are appropriate for the local consumption. This would distinguish technologies that need to go into macro-industrial production from the micro-enterprise. Appropriate technologies are those that respond to the local environment, resources, and economic needs. Raising public awareness on environmental and equity issues is indispensable for sustainable development. For the successful implementation of comprehensive and appropriate development issues, it is essential to educate the public, government, social and technical institutions, and business groups about comprehensive sustainable development issues. It is essential to ensure that the future generations are constantly made aware of sustainable development issues in their decision-making process. The subject must be introduced into basic educational curriculum. Just as an individual understands the implications of his daily financial decisions, similarly, he should be cognizant of the social and environmental implications of his actions. Land, the basic metrics of life. The other essential input for generating development activities is capital. The fact that you can create the land is in itself the core of the problem. Logically, it is the asset on the land that can be bought and sold, and not the land itself. Most developing countries are suffering from the ill effects of unsustainable land and credit-related financial policies. The manner in which land is valued is a typical example that has far-reaching effects. In most Asian countries, land has become the tradable commodity. Land values are often far greater than the produce of the land or the value of the asset on it. And again, any increase in the land cost beyond 4 times would result in the commodification of land. That consequently leads to the quality of construction being adversely affected. This then leads to the use of inappropriate building materials and complex process of problems is set in motion. Besides the financial and legal aspects of land issues that need to be reformulated, the physical characteristics of land need to be redefined. There is a general misconception that it is more economical to build on the flat land rather than on terrain. Historically, urban centers that were built on the higher ground were situated thus not only for military strategic reasons. Higher land lends itself to better drainage and more economical disposable systems owing to natural slopes. There are some pertinent lessons that we can learn from the past in order to have sustainable development in present. The largest single contradiction in our present-day planning methodologies is the relationship between roads and the drainage system. These roads require minimal slope while the drainage requires steep slopes, and yet we choose to combine the two by placing our drainage systems alongside roads. If the performance criteria of roads and drainage is taken separately, then the possible solutions emerge that are very different from the present day planning practices. In flatland areas, inappropriate and unsustainable road designs have become increasingly prevalent. The problems that arise stem from the fact that most roads without proper drainage coverlets are built higher than the adjacent lands. These roads act as mini check dams, causing waterlogging and flooding. This problem is further compounded when houses are consequently built higher than the roads. Since developments on the flatlands have inadequate soap for the natural drainage, deep waste and stormwater drains have to be built, once again generating a complex series of problems. Sustainable and appropriate water supply systems are vital for any urban center. At present, most water supply lines are placed underground, this being a primary cause for water-related disease problems in more ways than one. Since the water supply in a centralized system as we have today cannot be guaranteed around the clock, municipal authorities find it necessary to supply water during specific times, forcing households to store water often in unhygienic receptacles. Shutting down water supply at intervals causes vacuums in the pipe, resulting in their deterioration, thus contaminating the water with pollutants that are sucked in. One solution to this dilemma would be to, wherever possible, place water supply lines above ground level. This would reduce the amount of road digging undertaken by the municipal authorities wherever pipe repairs have to be done. The above ground pipes could then be incorporated into decorative fencing along the road boundaries. Where lines cross the road, they may be taken underground by sloping the pipe at an inclination of not more than 45 degrees. With this type of water supply system, unauthorized connections can be stopped by residents' associations and by empowering neighborhood associations. We acknowledge the advanced systems of planning adopted in the town planning strategies of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, and yet we fail to take cognizance of one of the strongest features of these developments. Traditionally, sewage and kitchen bath waste were never intermingled. Both of these were separated right at the source itself. The night soil as well as the water that was used were disposed of by allowing it to percolate into the soil. Whether this was done through localized pits or by physically lifting and disposing it in the pits at the distant locations, the night soil was never disposed of in combination with the kitchen and bath waste. Today, as things stand, Delhi is on the brink of major disaster. The water shortage has reached alarming proportions, and the next elections may well be contested on the assurances that the political parties can give with regard to water.
स्वाभाविक रूप से पहाड़ों से जो पानी आता था, वो लोगों ने बंद कर लिया है। जगह-जगह दिल्ली में तो विशेष करके फार्म हाउसेज जितने भी बने हैं, उन्होंने उन स्रोतों को भी बंद कर दिया जहाँ से पानी आ करके और जोहड़ों के अंदर जाता था। तो ये एक बड़ी विडंबना है। आप प्राचीन काल के
Now the essential appendix to Delhiite is a mobile phone in one hand and a bottle of mineral water in the other. The cell phone and computer may well be considered as a mark of mobility and the rapid progress of information technology, but a bottle of mineral water can hardly be considered a sign of progress. Using fixture designed to use the appropriate amount of water and customizing the stall wounds may give a better solution to the problem. The filtering of water is another major concern, and here is a simple solution.
It is believed that we require soft water to drink. The standards for potable water have been set to the standards for making good lather for soap. Isn't it absurd that soap has been given priority over our human bodies? Soft water has about 100 parts per million of dissolved solid. Our body requires about 300 parts per million. With the stress on bottled water as safe drinking water and the online filtration methods like reverse osmosis, our body's immune systems have become susceptible to the risk of cardiovascular problems, osteoporosis and other illnesses, owing to the removal of essential minerals. Be it the holy waters of the Ganga and Jamuna, or those of Lourdes in France, where water passes through limestone wells, you get the best waters, and these are used for religious purposes. When these contain traces of silver, they are literally worshipped. Silver in medicine and as a purifier has been acknowledged for centuries. These waters are stored in copper vessels for decades on. Coconut shell charcoal is one of the finest filters that removes E. coli and suspended impurities that have contaminated our groundwater. The common man's water filter is based on these time-tested principles. We have five copper vessels with holes at the bottom to allow passage of water. The use of copper vessels ensures the replenishment of this essential mineral. The first vessel contains unpotable water. The second vessel contains coconut shell charcoal. The third vessel contains marble chips, which are a highly compressed form of limestone. The fourth vessel contains white sand. The last vessel contains potable water and has a silver coin. This water has been tested and shown measurable results. Technology which is appropriate must be affordable, available, and understood even by a common man.
In Delhi alone, there are over 2 million vehicles, which requires nearly 6,000 hectares of paved parking. The water falling on these vast paved areas also finds its way into the famous stormwater drains. If we use the ferrocement jalis, that are the typical perforated concrete panels for the parking areas, and grow grass within the perforations, the result would be soft paved parking areas. The vehicles would not pressurize the roots of the grass and one could safely mow the lawn. A fringe benefit is the reduction of the heat buildup in the urbanized areas. Progress in our cities is synonymous with the number of flyovers, or so it seems. Taking a cue from Delhi, every town in India aspires for a flyover as a solution for their traffic problems. Designed by a trafficist, ostensibly to resolve the problems of vehicular traffic, the pedestrian, the child, and the physically challenged do not figure as an entity to be considered. But even resolution of vehicular traffic problem by building flyover is questionable. With nearly 70 flyovers in Delhi, almost making it the world's largest roller coaster, we seem to be further away from resolving the problems than ever before. Look at this bragged ambulance, covered a whole lot of distance, but caught in this vicious circle of roller coaster just 50 meters away from the hospital. Many more such as clover leaf flyovers are in offer. Los Angeles in the US is called the city of arteries with no heart, and we seem to be competing for this distinction. The simple solution for the problem is right here.
Most solutions for traffic problems focus on the efficient movement of vehicles. More often, the needs of the pedestrians, the cyclists, the invalid, and the children are considered as secondary. The rotary mode separator focuses on people as the primary consideration. And therefore, the resulting solution is simple and sustainable. The solution lies in keeping the pedestrian at zero level and allowing the HMV to move up to 2.5 to 3 meters onto an upper rotary and taking the LMV down 2.5 to 3 meters to an inner rotary.
The reason that developing countries seem to suffer from seemingly malfunctioning cities more than so-called developed countries has more to do with the efficiency of respective political and economic structures than anything else. High population densities, availability of resources, archaic dogmas, and modernization need not to be the stumbling blocks of sustainable development. We can learn from our historical past, immediate past, and the present to ensure sustainability through appropriate technologies, planning, and thinking. The developing nations are today following the advanced nations policy of achieving economic growth through macro-industrial production, which resolves around the concept of large-scale production and high consumption patterns. The consequent environmental impact is often overlooked. Broadly, if add-on costs exceed 40%, then the product or the means of production must be re-examined for the possible manufacture at the micro-industry level. Misuse of building materials is probably the largest single factor that contributes to environmental degradation. In the last century, the largest amount of development in the construction industry has been that of surfacing materials. Reinforced cement concrete was clearly not the answer, and it is to protect RCC that several surfacing materials have been developed, which also provide color and texture. A common misconception is that the life of a building depends upon the strength of the building material. This is incorrect. If the soil bearing capacity of earth is 2 to 3 kg per square centimeter, then it would seem irrational to use the building materials of 300 to 400 kg per square centimeter. The strength of the material required is the direct consequence of its surface requirements. Today, surface engineered building materials require serious consideration. Traditionally, a considerable amount of importance was given to the choice of materials to ensure the conservation of natural resources. It is the incorrect choice of materials that has resulted in the environmental degradation that we have today. A closer look at brick and the reinforced cement concrete establishes the incorrect evaluation of the materials that we choose to build with, reinforcing the efficacy of the mystical forms of establishing ecological balances. A lateral view opposing the mundane approach adopted for every component of a building is a revealing exercise. Let us look at the most ubiquitous actor in the building drama, the burnt clay brick. This tiny element of the building industry for the centuries has been most misunderstood. Today, the brick is considered a building material having universal application and standards. The sole determining factor is the crushing strength of the brick. However, the performance criteria around which the crushing strength has been formulated is often relegated to the background or has been long forgotten. Analyzing this thumb rule for crushing strength throws up a contradiction. Since the soil bearing capacity of the most soil is mere 2 kg per square centimeter, then the reason for using bricks of crushing strength of 150 to 200 kg per square centimeter is open to question. It seems highly illogical to use material of such high strength when the soil that building is to rest on is of lower crushing strength. The rationale is very simple. The strength determining factor for the brick is the direct consequence of its surface requirements. These were not mere flights of fancy, as they seem to be today, but the way of living. To relearn our heritage and the history and imbibe what is relevant for us in today's world and make it a way of living. All this cannot be achieved at once. A harmonious blend of the past with the present, tradition and the individual talent. That is what this film seeks to illustrate and prove. The issues raised are not merely for the sake of making one aware of the problems. Most of us are aware of these as we live in with them. The intent here is to rationalize the problems with a single objective of arriving at workable solutions. In order to arrive at the solutions, one finds it necessary to link the solution with the traditional wisdom of past. The best solutions are often so simple that they get disregarded because of their simplicity. Although within the past few decades, a number of institutions, research organizations and NGOs in India have worked in the field of sustainable development planning and appropriate building technologies and have made considerable headway. One of such exists coming away from the overcrowded scapes of Delhi, that is Anandpur Building Center. In between the barren rocky contours of Anandpur, in the district Faridabad, Professor Law laid the first brick of this exquisitely green and very distinctive building center in the early 90s. Two main problems exist in the current system. The first and the most important problem is the lack of integration of these efforts with the education system. Since development as well as the research in the field of sustainable human settlements and building systems is not linked with the academic institutions, consequently future architects and planners who continue to absorb outdated conventional methods cannot apply their skills in everyday working system. This lack of awareness also exists amongst the general public, who are further with a woeful lack of information and expertise. There is further no organized feedback of research and development in sustainable design into the institutions. The system remains static in absence of discerning coterie to advocate the necessary change. Any significant change may be effected through a cyclic link between agencies dealing with the sustainable development and educational institutions, so that appropriate development methods became a mainstream concern and expertise. The other problem is that the research institutions, development agencies and other organizations address each issue individually and in a singular way. Coordination and cross-sectoral work between these agencies is lacking, and thus development activities related to the design and management of the human settlement does not take place in a holistic manner.
And ma'am, you had a conference of CAC on green buildings recently, and there were not like any architects, and they were not even allowed to. That was only for the journalists.
That was a media briefing also. It was not a conference for everything. It was a media briefing.
No, you were discussing the green buildings and all,
yeah,
and also.
Yeah, but it was a media briefing workshop.
This is what happens now. That it should be done with like the known
mass. I'll tell you what, Saubhagya. See, I'll tell you. I'm not being condescending. I'm just telling you there is a.
Human settlements are the basis of all development activities and interaction of man with his environment. The building industry and the other activities related to human settlements account for nearly half of GNP in most developing countries. It is also the single largest factor that contributes to the environmental degradation and has a direct consequence on finance, productivity and social behavior. The design of human settlements encompasses a plethora of issues including land use strategies, watersheds and drainage systems, water supply, economic activity and resource generation, etc. Their sustainable approach in a holistic manner is a powerful mechanism for promoting appropriate development. These are just some of the issues pertaining to sustainable building technologies and appropriate building materials, and yet they form the core of sustainable development. To ensure consistent sustainable development at all levels, long-term strategies must envision the processes of manufacturing, creating viable livelihoods, appropriate technologies, and appropriate materials. Once these strategies are combined with the parameters set down, sustainable city strategies for developing countries can be implemented and a healthy future can be ensured.